Professor Titus.
Okay, yeah, I got to put on my professor cap.
and I got the hunchback and I got the sweep. I got the broom. So I'll be your assistant on this Dr. Frankenstein.
Shit, you Goodwill Hunting as far as I'm concerned. So ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another episode of The Weigh-In. The title of today's episode is Male Sexuality, an Examination and Reclamation.
Bring it down.
So stage one is sexual origins. And I like to begin this with a quote from Sigmund Freud.
Of all people, why not?
Yeah. We know less about the sexual lives of little girls than we do of boys. But we need not feel ashamed of this distinction. After all, the sexual life of adult women is a dark continent for psychology.
It's true. I mean, they found that out in the earliest days that when they tried to break it down, it was just like a... Whew.
Men are a little bit easier to like to kind of unpack than women are as far as sexuality.
It's true. And you know, and going back to Freud's time, men were predominantly in charge of so many different things. So, you know, men understood themselves a lot easier than women because women were treated kind of like dirt, you know, in many ways.
Yeah.
And but then we saw, like, if a woman was a little too excited, she had to have some electrical stimulation towards her vagina area and things like
that. Oh, yeah, there was
just
all
bizarre
there was all types of weird stuff going on, and luckily we're out of that. So, if the title seems a little bit obscure, so we're going to examine the sexuality of men, you know, coming up, and then we're going to teach men how to kind of reclaim that sexuality. Because, like, what I've observed in the world, you know, social media, politics, Hollywood, you know, etc., is that men... they can't really, like, exude their sexuality, you know, or they don't know how to. So, puberty normally begins between the ages of 9 and 14. This is when the sex organs begin to develop. The endocrine system manufactures and upregulates sex hormones. Young males become self-aware and also self-conscious. And the prepubescent ossification between the two sexes becomes less ambiguous. So you start to notice the girls. You start to notice that the girls are different. The body parts are different. You know, you're paying, you know, a lot of attention, more than you did prior.
You're aware of curves. They look prettier. Colors look nicer. And you just figure this out, whatever your age would be at this time. You just figure it out. Meanwhile, the young lady's been eyeballing this for about 2.5-3 years before.
Yeah.
Which is even wilder.
So, like, that's another thing going against us, because, like, the ladies, since they, you know, they advance, they mature faster than we do, they're up on the game before we are. So they're looking at us, they're formulating, they're getting that data in, and then we're just still left behind by 2.5 years.
Yeah, well, we're left behind for a reason, and it's not like it's anything particularly purposeful. However, we are designed, if you go back to an earlier time...
Caveman times.
Not even that far back, but, you know, man had to forage, and man had to do work.
Hunter-gatherers.
Yeah, they were in the blacksmithing areas, the horses are in the fields. The women were doing some of these things also, but, you know, they were there to help, you know, procreate the species and keep the family going for the next generations and stuff. So they, you know, obviously they didn't want to work them over too much. Where, I mean, you didn't want to like batter them too much, and didn't want to, you know, make them feel physically, you know, just not what they should be, or would not be able to have children. So, but since times have changed, it's a whole different story. But I think that's why they get a head start on them on a lot of things.
Absolutely, and the, you know, and coming into puberty, that is the start of the sexual energy starting to emerge, your sexual desire, you know, and like. That's when everything, like, that sets the stage. That actually sets stage two, you know. So once you start cultivating this sexual energy, what's the problem? The sexual lines start to get divided.
Yeah, it seems like it's the greatest thing in the world. And you're talking to them, you're walking home from school, you're touching, you're holding a hand. There's no kissing in that unless it's your, you know, unofficial girlfriend.
Mm-hmm.
But the joy of, like, walking home in a May or a June day from school with a girl who you think you love, and maybe she shows, not even love, but you really enjoy, you get a kick out of her.
You might even love her, because at that age, you don't really know what love is, and you don't really have any parameters to say, I shouldn't just fall, you know, fools rush in, so you just go in.
Yeah. But within a heartbeat, like, let's say that summer comes about after school's finished, and you're hanging out more, you're over at their house, there could be a pool, you go to the community pool, you're meeting up at the pool, it's like, you realize, this is a lot more complicated. Other boys are looking at her, I'm even looking at other women, but I still like her, and she knows that I might be like, why are you looking at her? I'm thinking, this was not the way it was 2 months ago when we were still in school. So it happens fast.
Yeah, so think about it. You're fascinated by your penis. You're like, oh shit, you like Dom and like Fast and Furious movies. You just, you know, you shifted to Garrett and like, what's this thing doing? You know, and you're also fascinated by the opposite sex. which you now seem to find mesmerizing and terrifying at the same time. Because you're mesmerized by the body, what's going on, how she's making you feel, but you're also terrified because now you're starting to move into like these structures that get built in, you know, and it's crazy. You know, because nobody really thinks about that paradox, you know, because once you enter high school, your introduction into high school is pretty much your initiation into hierarchies, cliques, and social sexual politics, you know. So every high school teen movie, TV show delineates the segregation of a student body. You got your jocks.
Yep.
You got your nerds. You got your pot smokers. You got the dudes in shop class. You got the goth kids.
Gothers,
yeah. Like everything's separated, you know. So now, instead of everybody just being the same, you're clicking up, you know.
Well, there's no guidelines. You have to kind of learn by trial by error, you know, a lot of this stuff.
Kind of feeling your way out.
Yeah, yeah, and you need to have trial by error. Exactly how it's exactly what it means. It's scary, it's dangerous, but if you don't follow that path, you're going to stumble even further, and you got to go with it. You can hope that you can get a little guidance at home. You ask your parents or your dad. You say, "What's going on?" You know, he might give you a low grade answer. He can't baffle you yet by the whole thing.
And think about how jarring that is. Like, you know, grade school, everybody was friends.
Yeah.
You know, everything was cool. Like until you get to high school, and it's just like everything just starts to change, and people start to drift away. So like you kind of feel abandoned. Plus, you got all this sexual energy that you don't know what to do with.
No, it's actually pretty insane. I remember myself personally. Maybe you went through the same thing. We get enamored with curves.
Yes.
Curves. The look of their chin. The
tiny
of their,
piece of a bra.
Yeah. I mean
dresses.
The top of the hip in a bathing suit. Mm-hmm. You go, wow, look at the size of that leading up to there, and mm-hmm. this and that. It's like. Wow. So, you know, the grand designer knew what he was doing exactly. Yeah. I mean, we know that breasts, obviously, for children to be fed and to be, you know, to be fortified with energy and stuff from their mother. But we are so enamored with them after, you know, there's no more breastfeeding going on. And they're really just, they're basically a fat tissue for the most part. But they move and they wiggle. I think something about curves is in the DNA that drives us up a wall.
Oh, without a doubt. We're definitely manufactured to seek these things out. And think about this. So there's three defining factors that kind of like proliferate, you know, what breaks up everything in high school. You have looks.
Lay it on me, man.
Financial status.
Ooh.
And engaged interests and activities. And this is kind of how you split up, you know, the cliques. This is some of the defining factors that, you know, dice everything up. And think about this. Cliques are formed out of two main ideations. Entitlement. Plus survival/shared interests.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
You know, like in Mean Girls, you got the plastics. They just feel entitled. They got the money. They got the looks. They dress better than everybody else. They sit at the certain lunch table. We don't even see you bitches. You know, like keep it pushing. Don't even look at us. You know, like I shouldn't even have to tell you this.
You know, in 7th and 8th grade, everybody's on the same playing field a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
You might be able to sense a little bit of the different groupings that are out there that you spoke of.
Yeah.
But it doesn't really happen until that summer after the end of 8th grade. And then you're about to enter high school.
Yeah.
Now it really begins to change a lot. So some girls that you might have even known or had a liking for, or maybe she smiled at you. Now it's a whole different ballgame.
And she's disregarding you.
Well, it's because she's now starting to change because of her click.
Yeah, it's almost like a lower level of hyper gaming, you know, where like the women got to get something because they feel like their body is now an asset.
Well, it's a social circle thing. I mean, they watch their parents. Girls watch their mothers.
Yeah,
they go to let's say they go to a golf course or a wedding at the country club. And, you know, some other schmo or a regular type of fella,
mm-hmm.
you know, his parents are just middle class all the way, and they don't see those kind of things. So they gravitate more towards their type of people, their type of groupings. And the girl comes back, and she's already, you know, she might have a sweater around her neck now. When you saw her before, she had sneakers on, no socks, a pair of shorts, and a striped blue and white T-shirt, right?
Yeah.
Now she's a little more prettier, and you're still in jeans and kind of half a bum still.
Yeah.
Because boys don't realize they got to get spiffy yet for another year or two. Some pick it up quicker, but a lot of guys are just, you know, I'm learning sports, I'm getting better at sports, I'm getting better at drinking, somebody brings a doobie around.
But the social dynamics aren't really, like, you know, inculcated yet.
No, they definitely aren't.
So it seems
magical at the beginning.
Definitely seems magical. Like, you're wooed by the wonderment. Like, it's insane. So think about this. Social sexual politics, you know, and this, we kind of get, like, once again, inundated in high school with this, you know. So all men are created equal. Until they reach high school, you know?
Yeah.
So That's when the moral meritocracy ends and the value of popularity ascends. You know, so everybody just being judged on merit out the door. So now it's a popularity contest. You know, maybe you got a nice car, maybe you got higher status. All this gets thrown in. You know, you are unwittingly thrust into a game of earning social capital, which you can then use to spend to increase your sexual market value. Wow. You know, and social capital, you know, is, you know, you're doing favors, you're being nice, you know, you're giving her your juice box, some shit like that, you know, you're writing her a letter, you know, like this is a young man trying to earn social capital, but with a woman, you know, and you're doing these things to increase your sexual market value. And sexual market value, you know, pretty much self-explanatory, you know, like, what is your value on the sexual market, you know? So you're just trying to do things to increase this, in which there's no playbook. So, like, you're just, you know, you're kind of strolling in the wind and you're thinking to yourself, if I do nice things, you know, maybe nice things, you know, I'll get nice things in return, you know, like a peck on the cheek and, you know, and like all the things that goes through like between 14 and 18 year old dude's mind, you know, like as he starts to develop, you know, and form his, you know, his sexual psychology, starts to look at things, you know, extremely different, you know.
Some boys pick up on it quicker, I notice, you know.
Yeah, but it's definitely politics, you know, like it's definitely, you know, definitely some things get embargoed, there's give and take, it's like capitalism and shit, it's wild.
If you're a fairly outgoing person and you can handle a decent little story, you can actually move a lot faster up that social ladder. Mm-hmm. And even though you think before this guy came along that you were moving up a decent social ladder with the girl that you were chatting with, and then you start realizing that the dude sort of already figures out how to dress a little bit better.
Yeah.
And he might have loafers on as opposed to sneakers.
Yeah.
And, you know, the other guy's got the sneakers on. They're starting to smell because he doesn't have a backup pair.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a lot of little things that guys take for granted and girls pick up on it real quick.
Yeah.
So every now and then somebody has a party and they all you get invited to it because you haven't been separated from that crowd yet. And you start realizing at the party that we don't fit.
Yeah.
And it happens quick. And I think I remember experiencing it myself,
And it's heartbreaking.
Oh, it breaks your heart.
When you start to realize, I can't compete with these dudes. They're just that more advanced. You know, maybe they had older brothers. Maybe they had a real hip uncle. Somebody that's kind of schooling them like, yo, start dressing like this. Take this little bottle of cologne, you know. And, you know, you need to start peacocking. You need to start standing out. But, you know, as a whole, like, we don't get that as men, you know.
Yeah,
and, like... But, like, somehow the politics are there at that. I'm fascinated that they're there at that age. Like, because I remember going to high school, and I just remember, like, seeing all the divisions of lines and thinking to myself, like, I came from, a lower-class home, and I'm just like, fuck, girls ain't even going to notice me because my sneakers ain't right. My sneaker game is trash, you know. every dude knows that feeling, or most dudes know that feeling where they're looking like, this ain't gonna cut it. I got these buddies on.
The buddies.
Dude over there got them Jordans. Yep. He about to win.
Yep.
I remember dudes getting Jordans and I'm just like, what the fuck am I supposed to do? I remember dudes getting Jordans and thinking to myself, what am I supposed to do with that?
I know. Yeah, it's hard. And actually, when you're young, you get a little tear in your eye, you cry a little bit, you get a little offended.
Yeah.
You take it personal. You know, you called it a political struggle and a political change is happening. It actually is. Mm-hmm. But a better word for it is just the peer pressure, mm-hmm. which actually, it's a form of politics. But, you know, it's not obviously in Capitol Hill, you know, it's not in Washington. But peer pressure is a form of politics. And the structure, if you don't play it well and you don't got a good, you don't have a good bid to be elected, you know, what do you call that when you got a campaign manager?
Yeah,
if you're
you
not,
got a whole staff.
Yeah, you don't got your shit together early, you're kind of sad shape. There's
buckets.
Always one dude who'll take care of you. There's always like your little buddies, a little shorter.
Yeah.
Girls kind of like him because he's kind of friendly. He's maybe the nerd. He's the nerd of your group, even though you're a bunch of rats or a bunch of goths, whatever it might be. And he sets things straight for you, helps you out with the girls. But then you're too bashful to talk to her now. Or at least because now you start realizing she wants me to go out. We're going to catch a movie. I don't know where to go. I don't have any money. I don't have a ride. My parents are going to say something. It gets out of control fast.
Absolutely.
But we keep trying to fight it, man. We know we can pull it together, you know? That's the charm of it all.
Like, you definitely have to do that. So that brings us to stage 3. Male sex drive is akin to Dexter's dark passenger in society's eyes.
Oh boy, you mean Dexter? Yeah, definitely Dexter from the TV show.
Yeah,
yeah.
So, treated as a primitive artifact from man's sexual evolutionary history, society wants you to bury your urges in some forgotten wing of your emotional museum. you know. And like burying a seed in the ground, the lizard brain's desire will only develop. So basically, society is telling you to repress your urges at this point. Your dude is like 16, 17, you know. You in the middle of high school. You going to junior proms and shit. You know, like, you like, I'm seeing these girls. I'm trying to make moves, you know. So who do you go to for advice? Most schools, parents, inadequate and incapable of talking about sex, you know. Society is telling you to keep in your pants, you know, like your grandmother used to say, boys, pants up and girls, dresses down, you know. So where's a young man to turn to in these days? Your friends and the internet. So your friends are going to deliver more inadequate advice, and the internet, i.e. porn, is going to hyper-stimulate you and paint a false narrative.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so, and that's sad because it's bigger than ever because of how things are streaming nowadays and whatnot. So you get no opportunity to properly understand how to work with the woman and do what you need to do. So now you think that she's just a sex object and you disrespect her. You don't even realize you're disrespecting her because
you're dehumanizing her.
Correct. Yeah, exactly what you're doing because you're not seeing her for the cute little girl she was in seventh grade.
Mm-hmm.
Now you start thinking it's just about the raw energy that I've been told I should have.
Yeah, and think about this.
That's complicated if you don't actually know what you're doing, because you could get arrested, you can get in trouble, even at a young age.
Yeah, no, there's serious things that you could, serious paths that you can go down. And think about this. You got these hyper-sexualized women who are doing and saying all of these things that a normal girl, especially at your age, is not about to be into.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. The kids today, they got the internet, they got the porn, they got the whole streaming thing. But back in my era, mm-hmm. the innovation that really got down to the nitty-gritty was the halter top. Remember those that girls would wear those? They had sometimes, most of the times, there was no brassiere underneath that. And everything would just be jumping around. And you're like a fucking teenage boy, and you're like, you got the rocket.
You're going off like fireworks.
So anyway, us to the number...
So now that we've examined male sexuality, how it comes up, how we feel about it, you know, how society feels about it, what's going against us, now it's time to reclaim our sexuality. So, the first thing in reclaiming our sexuality, stop masturbating, number one. Stop it. So, you decrease your desire to date, you decrease your attraction to real-world women, you simultaneously become less attractive by being less attracted to women. And it's an overall sex drive killer, which enslaves you to an unrealistic fantasy and behavioral loop. So every time you pull on the stick, you're not willing to go out and try to meet women. Because you're getting your instant gratification in the bed. You're accepting that more than going out and actually dating women.
I think a lot of boys do it. I would think that a lot of boys would probably do it if they're having problems with girls. They figure they don't have the potential for girls. They're releasing that sexual tension that they've had built up, you know.
Yes.
And it's not a good thing to keep on doing forever, because the more you do it, you know, you're thinking of a girl that you kind of like who wants nothing to do with you anymore. And sometimes the evil animosities can build up. And if anybody has a short fuse or any kind of a situation going on with their own, you know, their own brain and stuff and their personality and stuff, could be dangerous.
Definitely could drive them into some darker places.
Yes, exactly.
But and think about the aspect, too, of you're less attractive by being less attracted to women. You know, like, once you're getting off, you know, twice a day at home, you know, multiple times on the weekend, when you go out and you actually see a member of the fair sex, you're kind of like,
Yeah, it could demystify a little bit. I mean,
yes.
It definitely builds up barriers. It could be the beginning. No sooner do males realize that, oh, look what I got down between my legs.
Yeah.
And that becomes a great element of fun for a while there. And then within a heartbeat
of time. But it's a cop-out.
It is. But within a heartbeat of time, it becomes a major cop-out, like you're saying. And now it becomes like, well, I'll settle for this because I'm not going to get that. Or now I'm building up this defensive wall towards her and maybe her girlfriends.
Yeah.
And maybe females in general, because I know I'm not going to be able to get it. So in the same breath of air, it goes from wonderment to, like, detriment.
Yeah, absolutely. And
it's a scary thing, you know, because once you're having your, you know, when you're popping your cork, so to speak, you do feel like you're on top of the world for that, like, you know, 10 seconds, 6 seconds, whatever the hell it might be. And
but it's just not real.
It's not realistic for sure.
So number two, admiration versus obsessive behavior. You need to learn the difference.
Yeah.
So admiration is respect for a woman's mind, body, personality. general concern for her well-being, willingness to bond without an agenda, and honesty. You know, so respect her mind, you know, respect her, you know, hopefully you're not dealing with no thoughts, you know, like, the, you know, no dummies, you know, respect her body, you know, no means no for all the fucking dummies out there, you know, like if a woman says no, if you're too close, you know, this is a no harassment, you know, weigh-in policy. Women do not get harassed around here. We do not tolerate it. You know, and tolerate her personality. You know, like, get to know her personality. Get to know who she is, you know, as a woman, as a person. You know, and have a general concern for her well-being. You know, like, this is part of admiration. Like, you know, call to ask how she's doing, you know, but you don't have the agenda.
Well, I think males used to actually... think more about getting to know the girl before they were worried about the agenda. And it almost like society forces the agenda to the
agenda
top.
Being sex.
Of course. But it forces it to the top of your list, you know?
Yeah.
It becomes a thing on your clipboard you gotta take care of first, you know?
Yeah. It should be organic. It should be natural, you
know? Well, there was a time, and it's still out there, don't get me wrong.
Yeah, definitely.
But there was a time when it was like, you know, let's go back to like, I don't know, anywhere between the... post-World War II, straight on up to like the 70s and the 80s, when everything got all
super sexualized.
When everything got super sexualized in those 3 decades, you know, leading up to the 80s. And the 80s, everything starts to change a little bit more because technology is now starting to come on. But girls were told by their parents to, you know, be careful, make sure you don't do this real fast. You don't got to dress sexy because you're not really hunting for a boy yet.
Yeah.
Because you're still learning. You would date. You learn about the girl. Where you going to go to?
You're
going to college.
That's what you should be doing.
Right. Not no more. We live in a...
Everybody's trying to jump into sex.
Yeah, we live in a NASCAR world, man.
Yeah, that's facts.
We're going 500 miles an hour nonstop all the time.
Big facts. So, obsessive behavior, for those who don't know, and this is not all the characteristics, but some, is jealousy. You know, especially jealousy if you're not... As a matter of fact, we'll just cap it. Any jealousy is bad.
Yeah.
You know, no matter what. You shouldn't have those feelings. You should be able to talk to your partner if you're with her, if it's pre, post, you know... Or during, you should be able to talk to her and you shouldn't be jealous. The objective ownership tendencies. She is not a thing. She's a person.
Yeah.
You don't own her. You know, you own your car. You own your house. Or you mortgage your fucking house. You know, you know, et cetera, et cetera. But you do not own another human being. You don't even own your fucking kids. You take care of your kids, but you don't own her. So don't look at her like that. Social media stalking. You're looking at her Twitter, you're on her Instagram, Facebook, you know, doing that creeper thing, you know, like, you know, trying to see what she's doing, trying to see where she's at, you know, it's weird. Just don't do it.
It is weird. Well, some of these pretty girls will dress provocative.
But I'm
not saying it's an excuse.
Yeah.
I'm just saying they wear provocative clothing and apparel. And some of the stalker type dudes are going to go check it out because she sort of sent the vibe. She didn't do it purposely. And I'm not saying like, oh my God, you know, you can't do this. But I still think you got to be a little cautious on what you do and what you say.
Absolutely.
I mean, too many people, you know, take things for granted. I know society tells us to act and look pretty and look kind of sexual and show more of your skin and be kind of cute and, you know. It's dangerous. I mean, but I still understand it. It's important.
Yeah.
You know, but
that's women and men allowed to have their sexual freedom, you know, without being stalked. I'm just trying to explain to the dudes you don't want to have these stalking behaviors.
Yeah.
So, text or DM bombing. So, text or DM bombing is simply you text her like 100 times, you know, in 30 minutes. Or you
nightmare.
DM her like 1,000 times in an hour. Like, where you at? What you doing? Why you ain't texting me back? Don't do that. All of that behavior, like, all that needy behavior is just, it's the wrong energy and you're pushing her away.
Yeah.
You know, and any overall disregard for a personal space, whether it be on or offline, you know, is obsessive behavior. It's not going to get a woman to like you. It's only going to push a woman away. You know, like, it's polarizing. Like, she's just not going to want you. So, 3, freedom from sexual outcome. You know, so you have to have a willingness to have a platonic relationship. You have to have a willingness to walk out of her life forever, the ability to be single or alone, and the ability to regulate, not repress, your sexuality. Okay, so you got to be able to have friends. You got to be able to have friends that are females that you're not gonna have sex with. You know, like the platonic relationship.
Sure.
It is what it is. You have to have that, and you need that because women shape you. Like we said in a previous episode, you know, how men sharpen men, steel sharpens steel. The same way, women will sharpen you. The more women that you have, the more healthy female relationships that you have, the more you're going to be able to understand women, you know.
It's true, but some of the things you're talking about there, I would say it's probably more related to like the later days of high school, mm-hmm. leading into where you're going to go to college or to until a community college.
It's a little bit more advanced.
Yeah, but you definitely have to be looking at it at that point there.
Yeah.
You can't be, if you're thinking about that when you're a sophomore, you're really way a little too advanced.
Yeah.
In some ways, because you still need to, every one of these different schools that you go through, whether your grammar schools, your high schools, your middle schools, your college, whatever it is, each one of those has dedicated things you need to tackle. And their tasks. If you can get through them and understand the situation, you'll be in a great situation to do what you just talked about right here.
Absolutely.
I totally agree.
You have to have a willingness to be able to walk out of her life. Some people are not going to be compatible.
That's not easy, man, but yeah. You got
to
try.
And she can be the most beautiful girl in the world. You have to be willing to walk out of her life. Mm-hmm. And a companion to that, if you have to have the ability to be single and to be alone. A dude who can't stay at the house alone and needs to call a girl and is constantly texting different girls because he can't sit in the house by himself is never going to get a girl because they feel that needy energy because that's what it is.
Yeah.
You know, you need to have a purpose. You need to have something that directs you that's not a woman, that's not another physical person that takes up your time, that, you know, fascinates you, that's not a female. And then you'll get the female because you have the purpose. Your own, you know, women are attracted to that.
Remember some friends every now and then around this particular time, and the way you're breaking it down for, mm-hmm. for the public here is mm-hmm. where you had the friend who met a girl and he's getting a little hot and heavy, mm-hmm. and he's thinking like, this is my girlfriend, and I realize it's his first girlfriend and there's going to be probably many more.
Yeah.
And they become the invisible buddy. Like, you know, they were great up to seeing this girlfriend. Everybody was hanging out at the park and at the school play yard, and all of a sudden the dude was gone. Now he's got the pussy love going on.
Yeah.
Or a pussy whooped, as we would say. It's a negative term. But I mean, but this dude would not show up anymore. But as soon as he took the girlfriend home, you know, because she couldn't be out past a certain age because he was still a teenager, he'd come running back to us guys and whoever it might be, or all your pals who are still in the parking lot. It's now dusk, right? Somebody was able to find somebody to buy a six pack for you,
mm-hmm.
and now he's one of the buddies, and somebody would say, oh, now we're important to you. You know, that was always a very annoying thing, but you know, once you got one, you think it's your girlfriend, you can't sleep at night sometimes when you think you're in love. It's a crazy thing. It's like, I got this girlfriend, I'm getting
love
some kisses,
pulls at your soul.
Maybe a couple squeezes here and there. And I'm going to go back to my goofy friends, and they're going to go like, yeah, what's up? And you're going to go like, hey, man, I was busy. Sorry. What am I supposed to do? You know, I've seen this happen before, you know?
Absolutely. And the last part tying up this third rule is you have to have the ability to regulate, not repress, your sexuality. So you can flirt with a girl, but you can't think that everything that you say, everything that, you know, she does, it's her, you know, giving you a come on or giving you an invitation. That's where a lot of dudes fuck up. They can't read the signs and they're like, oh, she smiled. Oh, she trying to smash. Yo, shorty is down. She DTF. She down the fuck. No, it's not. It's not like that all the time. You got to be able to read that. And you got to be able to maintain that. You may have a friend. Like, I have a lot of friends, a lot of female friends who are gorgeous, sexy as fuck to me. And, you know, and like, we have that relationship, we've never had sex, and we're not gonna have sex. Maybe we're not gonna have sex. I mean, if any of my friends out here listening wanna have sex, you know? But DTF, you know? But you gotta know how to regulate that energy, you know? So moving on to the fourth lesson, you have to have strict personal standards for a partner, you know? So maybe you want somebody that's smart. Maybe you want somebody that's funny. Maybe you want a certain body type. Maybe you want somebody that doesn't do drugs at all. Maybe you want somebody that lives and deals with rationality. Like you have to have like somebody in your life that you want. And if you're willing to settle for anything, you're gonna get anything. You know, you can't just absorb everything. Like, you have to have somebody that you want, and it's gotta be by design.
Well, the elements that we're talking about here in this particular heading here that you're bringing on,
mm-hmm.
I mean, let's put this in better perspective. Like, we're probably looking at age like 17 to 20 here, or a little older.
This right here can be 17 to 90.
Okay, you know? I hear you.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's sometimes
general rules.
Some of it's a little... there are general rules. I mean, I still think if you're already having sex, you still have to realize that when she makes a nice smile, it doesn't mean it's not time to fool around in the
bush. Big facts.
That's what I was kind of...
No.
Yeah. But if you're not getting sex, follow these rules. You're golden.
Yeah.
But, you know, I don't think I've met many males that have done that, but they usually take it personal. They get mad. They get all nervous. They get breakouts on their face.
No. But that's very, very true.
It's two sides
even
of that story.
Even if she smiles,
right,
even if you're already having sex, just because she smiles or, you know, punches you around a little bit doesn't mean it's time to jump into sex. So, number five, increase your sexual market value. Develop a fit body. exercise regimen. And you develop a fit body not to look like a chiseled, you know, Instagram model dude, but it's more in the lines of, like, if you go back to, like, genetic inclusive fitness, that Darwinianism, like, if you're active, if you're strong, you just make for a better sexual mate, you know? A rigorous hygiene protocol, aka take baths and use deodorant every single day.
Oh, yeah.
As much as you can, you know. Develop a sense of style. You don't have to have anything crazy, yeah. You know, but just have some, you know,
be nice and established,
neat. Yeah, just be nice and neat. Nothing, you don't need nothing crazy. And then accoutrements, you know, if you want. Nice car, maybe. Maybe some jewelry.
Yeah.
You know, maybe some cologne. So the last thing I would like to add, you know, just kind of tying this up, is allow her to chase. Too many dudes DM random girls on Instagram. They don't know how to build sexual tension. Like, if you got a friend, you like her, you look into her eyes, smirk, play around with her, you know, tease intimacy, you know, get close.
Yeah, flirting.
You know, and start to pull the energy back a little bit, you know, and allow the woman to chase you. Women, just like men, don't want anything that's easy. They want a little bit of a challenge. They want to kind of earn a very good man and say, hey, I have to work for this. This dude is mine. You know, like, allow women to have that. That's part of their, you know, their feminine makeup, where they can just be like, okay, I got to chase this dude. I got this dude. These other girls couldn't get him. I got him. I'm his woman, you know.
You know, back in the day when I was younger, that type of situation would come up every now and then. And I used to always tell friends, we would all talk about this stuff. It was always like, you know, obviously, I noticed you're getting kind of hot and heavy with that girl, mm-hmm. You know. Her name is, you know, just call her Debbie for a name, right?
Deb.
You're getting pretty hot and heavy, mm-hmm. with Debbie and whatnot. And the friends will say, like, dude, what you got to do is, you know, don't have to call her back every time she gives you a call.
Play a little hard to get.
Yeah, because then she's going to appreciate you more.
Yes.
And nowadays, they don't understand that. You play the cat and mouse game. Now, yes. These dudes, they just fall flat over, head over heels. They fall flat on their face over this
long. Trying to give her a house and a dowry.
Yeah.
Like, just take everything.
And then she might have the hots for you at first, but now she's dogging you and dodging you because
it's that needy energy.
Yeah, she doesn't want, but she's like, I don't really know if I want to put up with a guy that's this needy.
Stage 5 clinger dude.
Yeah, it's the worst. One, man. You know, there are a lot of dudes who actually like females and females who like males of that nature, where one could be sort of like the alpha male or alpha female,
yeah.
And they're very happy with that type of relationship. A lot of guys and girls just
it's a little bit against the norm, but it does.
Yeah, they definitely need somebody to control the relationship. That usually leads to problems in a lot of relationships, I'm not saying don't do it if you can. But anyway, so that's about it for this particular episode.
Absolutely. So, ladies and gentlemen, that was Male Sexuality, an Examination and Reclamation. Follow those rules, and you'll be on your way to make a lovey time.
Yep.
That's the way in, baby. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another episode of The Weigh-In. And the title of today's episode is Michael Keaton, the best Batman ever.
You're on to something there. You are on to something.
Ooh, Gen Z millennials. Gen X probably a little bit triggered too. Whatever.
That's waking everybody up.
We about to salute the king. Keaton the King.
Go ahead. So, give me some more data.
So you can't talk about Michael Keaton without talking about that first Batman film.
1989,
you
know, folks.
Batman 1989. So let me give a quick overview.
Sure.
So directed by Tim Burton, and it was starring Michael Keaton, Kim Basinger, Billy Dee Williams, Robert Wall, Jack Palance,
Jack.
You know, aka Curly from City Slickers, you know. Awesome cast. There was many more people. The score and most of the music was done by Danny Elfman, who was like an OG, does phenomenal, you know, music. So the release date was June 23rd, 1989. It had a worldwide gross of $411 million off a $35 million budget, which is like $1 billion at the time.
Oh, easily. You know? Today it would be crazy.
The cinematography was done by Roger Pratt, who just did a phenomenal job. And fun fact, it was the highest grossing movie of that year.
Yeah, it was a phenomenon in every sense.
Yes.
Commercialization, toys, TV show, Burger King, McDonald's, T-shirts, sneakers, everybody was a Batman.
Now, I was a kid back then, so like I was caught up in the hype, but like the optics where I was seeing from my kid brain weren't as good. What do you remember? Like how grandiose, how exuberant, how large was the hype for this movie?